Mark, are you ready? All right, 10 minutes. Are you good? 10 minutes? All right, Mark Holcomb.
Awesome. Look at all you guys. Did you call me daddy? I haven't been called daddy since I was at home. No, I'm just kidding. And it's Friday, so I always like think to myself, people are gonna have something better to do. But you know what? I may be wrong about that, but I promise you this is gonna be a really, really fucking fun time tonight. This is gonna be awesome, really. No. For a couple reasons. One, we haven't played a show. Like, who's seen Periphery here? Or I guess in Indiana before. So there's not very, so you guys had to travel. Where'd you guys have to travel to? Just yell it out. Oh my gosh, wow. That's a shame. It's a crying shame. I can't even remember the last time we played Indianapolis, to be fair. I don't think we ever have. Yeah. So, okay. I saw about a dozen hands go up. So there's a good bit of you who have seen Periphery play, who've seen my band play. And whenever I announce these clinics, the number one question I get is like, what is it? Do you just talk for an hour? Do you play songs for an hour? Is it like you playing Periphery songs for an hour? And I always say it opens up the dialogue two ways, because when you go see a Periphery show, it's us playing music at you for an hour or 70 minutes. When you come to one of these, I'm gonna play songs, I'm gonna talk about the gear. I'm gonna talk about way nerdier stuff than you've heard me talk about before. The guitars, the pickups, the pedals, the amps, everything that I use, the ins and outs of Periphery, really. This is my third clinic in 3 days. I did one in Tampa 2 days ago, and then I did one in, last night. Michigan, yeah, that's where I was last night. And here I am. And lately we've been talking a lot about the music industry, because Periphery just started our own record label about a year ago. And yeah, thank you. It's a big step. One that I don't know how it's gonna pan out just yet, but it's a vehicle for our own music. It's a vehicle for our side projects, for Haunted Shores, for 4 Seconds Ago, for all that stuff. And it's a vehicle for bands that we like. So we're trying to sign bands. We're trying to find talent that we believe in and support. But that's been a huge topic lately. But in summation, these clinics cover all that kind of stuff. And really, it's driven by you guys. So I can already tell you guys aren't shy. So as we go along this clinic, I want to open it up for questions as we progress throughout. And I have no doubt you guys have no shortage of questions. If you've ever written me on social media, you know that I suck at replying, so I'm sorry. But this is what I save it for, because I'd much rather, instead of using my thumbs to type, I've already got really bad, thumb tendonitis from video games, Pokemon Go too. I can't really get back to everybody on social media. So this is the perfect platform for it. So if you guys have any questions, curiosities, anything like that, please, as the next 60, 90 minutes go along, feel free to ask me anything. So that's what's different about this. It's not a band playing music at you. This goes two ways. I'm gonna play for you, but I also wanna hear from you guys. Does that sound good? Yeah. Cool. Thank you guys. Hey, by the way, thank you for spending your Friday night here with me. That's awesome. Like, that always blows me away. I've done so many clinics, and these Friday night ones, like whenever you guys come out and choose to spend your valuable time, you guys paid to be here, that fucking blows me away. That's crazy. So can we thank more guitarists for throwing this real quick? This is not normal. Like, this setup, I walked into this shop and I thought that was all they had in that room over there, if you guys have been in the actual store. And then I walked into this room And I swear, Periphery has played way crappier venues than this. Like, this is a venue. This is a legit venue. You could have a full band. That's a monstrous green room back there. Like, dude, put a foosball table. You guys be set. Yeah, we're coming here. See you in a week. No, but this is fantastic, man. So yeah, take advantage of awesome stores like this. I grew up in Southern California. I spent the 90s in Southern California with a ton of music shops around. And to be quite frank, none of them really had anything on a store like this. So don't take shops like this for granted, trust me. Yeah, hell yeah, yeah. As you can see, they have quite a number of PRSs here. And am I correct in saying 15% off? Yeah, 15% off everything. They had everything ready to go. But being the worrywart that I am, I brought my own stuff, too. And I did it for a couple reasons. One, because I'm a creature of habit. And I like things that are comfortable in my hands. And I'm so tough to change it up. I don't know if you guys are that way too, but if I have a guitar that I love, the way it feels in my hands, it's really tough for me to put it down. And I feel nervous about changing it up, which is why I play what I play. So I brought my own. This is my own personal six string that I just toured for a month on. I brought it everywhere, and I'm going to Europe in a week and a half, and I'm bringing this. It's gonna be my main six. And another reason I brought it is because after this is over, I want to hang out with them. I want to meet each and every one of you guys. If you want, I'm going to leave this stuff sort of at the front of stage so you guys can come up and play it and get your hands on it. And I want you to feel the difference between what I play on stage and what you'd find on a store wall, which is what that is. And that is right there, the two six strings. So that belongs to the store. Those are for sale. But I want you guys to get an idea of, I guess, the quality guitars that I play on stage, because people see the price of my PRS signature model and they're like, it's $900. There's no way that guy plays a $900 guitar on stage. But I do, and I have for 6 years in a row. And I make two changes on my production models, or sorry, for my stage models. I add locking tuners for an extra layer of stability. I don't know how many people are in bands here, just out of curiosity. That's a good number. Okay, ish, me too. Yeah. So that's like, it looks like about a dozen and a half of you guys are in bands. That's awesome. One of the things I learned playing live early on was that the less you got to worry about on stage, the more you can focus on your job, the more you can focus on what you got to do. If you're worrying about your cable coming loose, or if you're worrying about your tubes dying in your amp, or if you're worried about your guitar going out of tune, it takes away. Right? It subtracts from the amount of energy and focus you're able to put into your instrument. So for me, having an extra layer of stability on stage is mandatory. And the other change that I make is I put these hip shot knobs. It's a really cheap switch. That's it. It's kind of aesthetic. It's kind of comfort related too. But that's the only difference between what you'd find on a store wall and what I play live. And a lot of people ask me, they're like, what's different about your signature model compared to the rest of the PRS lineup? And the answer is very simple. There's two big things. One is scale length. So on an average PRS, you pick up any of these PRSs, I believe the average scale length is 25 inches. I have 25 and a half. And people ask, what difference does a half inch make? And you ask any married man, no, I'm just kidding. I know, it's like it's impossible for that not to be sexual whenever I say it. But anybody who's ever tuned low, right? And okay, this is the ceiling. This is Periphery's ceiling for what our tunings are. Okay. This is the highest you'll ever hear Periphery tune. It's drop C. That's the highest. So if that's the ceiling, That means we go a lot lower. And we do. So you need a scaling that can accommodate that kind of tuning. And that involves other things too. That involves your string gauges. Are you using two light string gauges or are you using two heavy string gauges? And I'll tell you what I use, because this has been a battle for me for a decade and a half now. I've been experimenting with long scales and low tunings and string gauges for so long. And my comfort zone is 11 to 56 string gauge, 25 and a half inch scale length, because you get that sort of shredder feel on a guitar. You guys ever play a baritone? Baritone guitar? Jumbo, jumbo, jumbo frets, just like enormous frets. And it covers low tunings well, but what you lose, in my opinion, is the ability to play leads fluidly. The frets are so big that it kind of feels unwieldy when you go to the higher parts of the neck and you start trying to play more intricate, complex lead lines. So 25 and a half inches is sort of the sweet spot for me. And I've road tested this for years and years and years. And yeah, we tune a lot lower than that too, so you need that extra half inch, you really do. And then the second thing that distinguishes this guitar from the rest of the PRS lineup is a 20 inch fretboard radius. So for those of you who are not dorks like me, that means it's a completely flat fretboard. If you were to be right where I am right now, you could see that the fretboard is flat. You guys ever pick up like a Spanish classical guitar? You'll feel the fretboard is flat. It's as flat as a table. There's no curvature. A lot of people who love strats and tellies, they get used to that curved fretboard. And it feels nice. But for me, I always found that I could do this really wide vibrato and get away with bending a lot easier on a flat surface. So this is totally flat. I just love the way. So used to the way a flat fretboard feels. There's no resistance, because when you bend strings across a curve, you're getting resistance. And that feels nice to a lot of players. I actually like picking up a telly or a strat sometimes to just get a little bit of a different feel. But for me, this is home. Bending across a flat surface, that's home. You pick up any shredder guitar, any guitar from the 80s, and they all have that flat fretboard. And then, of course, the pickups. These are Seymour Duncan Alpha and Omega pickups in here. The centerpiece of the set is probably the bridge. It's the Omega. And what sets it apart is two things, actually. So there's what I call the sort of caveman ignorant sound, you know? The really pissed off, snarling, belligerent sounding tone. This really aggressive, like punchy attack, but a lot of pickups get that type of quality, right? What a lot of pickups don't do is get that and nail big chords. Because if you listen to my music, if you listen to Periphery's music, you'll know that we use a lot of big chords without changing pickup positions. We'll go from this to this. How on a chord like that, the notes are all audible. You're not getting those notes lost in a you know, just a massive gain. And don't get me wrong, there's a shit ton of gain on this channel. There's a lot of gain. But you're not compromising the content of the chord. Which, if you play a big chord and you're losing all the notes, what's the point of playing the chord? You may as well just play power chords, you know? But what sounds better, this or this? So yeah, that's what we have pickup-wise in the guitar, and it's something special. Again, it's home for me, you know. If you ask what I play at home, this is exactly what I play at home. Amp-wise, I'm using the Mark Tremonti Signature amp. It's MT-15. It's a PRS amp, and it's killer. No tube screamer, so everything that you're hearing is all coming directly from the amp. It's pretty impressive, because the gain is only at about 2 o'clock. So if you want to get more ignorant, you can. I'm not going to, but I'll just keep it right where it is because it sounds really good. Before I go on, actually, you know what? Can I play a song for you guys? Is that okay? Awesome. You guys are like, please shut up and just play music, monkey boy. I will. But first, let me show you another reason why we have a 25 and a half inch scale length in this guitar, because this is a tuning. Yeah. So this is drop G. What I just did was tune the sixth string all the way down to G. So it's an octave of the fifth string. It's a really low tuning. It sounds like an eighth string. A lot of people comment on YouTube, they're like, why do you guys play an eighth string tuning on a sixth string? And I'll answer that in a second. But it's a low G. So, FYI, can I play a little bit of song Reptile for you guys?
We'll be right back. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a cartoonishly low tuning. And I was saying before, it's drop G. So it's an octave of your fifth string. Actually, the first time I heard that tuning was Dimebag Darrell using it. Sandblasted Skin off of Great Southern Trenco. Oh. But yeah, it's such a satisfying low, just like a meander. It feels dumb. You feel like a caveman when you're playing it because it's so easy to sound heavy. And it's kind of a beautiful thing. Going back to the question that people ask, they're like, why do you use an eight string tuning on a six string? Why do you tune so low? Why not just pick up a seven? Or why not pick up an eight string? Why do you tune this all the way down? And the answer is actually pretty simple. I get stuck in ruts. I have creative ruts. How many songwriters, how many people here write music? Yeah, okay, that's a good number of you. That's a lot of you. I don't know if you guys have this. I have it a lot. I get stuck in creative ruts. And a lot of the time, I get really down on myself. Like I get really demoralized and my confidence is low because I can't write. And nothing I write is good. At least that's what's in my head. And the first thing I do, you know, after 23 years of playing guitar and a long time, you know, doing this professionally, the one thing I've learned that works for me a lot of the time is if I'm writing in standard or if I'm writing in drop D or drop C and I have nothing, I'll throw my guitar in a different tuning and just see what comes out. And more often than not, like I won't always write something cool, but it'll get me using my ear, right? So like, You know how sometimes you have the same moves on guitar? You play the same pentatonic lick, you play the same stuff, the same riffs over and over and over again, the same licks.
You've heard me play it, Aaron.
What's that?
You've heard me play it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, but everybody, I feel like everybody has our own go-to moves, right? And it's visual. Guitar is a visual instrument. It's like piano. It's really easy to digest it on a visual level once you learn how things go on a neck. And what throwing your guitar in a different tuning does is it makes all those moves, all your go-to moves, it makes them all bullshit. None of it makes any sense anymore, so you can't just rely on them. So now you have to use your ear, which, contrary to what you would think as a guitar player, we don't do a ton of, you know? At least when I get into my ruts, I'm not using my ear. I'm like, how much of my ear am I using versus my eyes when you look at a guitar? Using your eyes to recognize patterns and to play those patterns. But once you throw your guitar in open C or open D or drop G or some wild ass tuning, you start to use your ear more. And that's the whole point of the exercise. And when I threw my guitar in this tuning, it was before Periphery 4. It was for before the Hailstand sessions. I was writing for the album and I messaged the guys. I was like, hey guys, I'm a little worried about my own level of inspiration for this record. Like, I haven't written a lot. And they actually said the same thing. They're like, I don't have a ton written either. So we were worried, legitimately, as a group. And I threw my guitar in this tuning on Christmas vacation before recording that album. And I just thought it was such a fun tuning. You could do a bar chord and have it just sound massive. And I thought it was so fun that I wrote two riffs in like an hour. The first riff of Reptile. And then the verse riff I wrote directly after that. They're notey and they're all over the place and, you know, it's acrobatic and whatever, but it's all inspired by the tuning. I thought the tuning was so fun that the inspiration poured out of me. So I would recommend it. I know there are a lot of guitar players who are kind of weary of throwing their guitar in a different tuning spontaneously. They think you have to re-gauge your strings and like adjust your setup. Don't even worry about it. Don't worry about it. That stuff's not that important. If you're a creative musician, focus on that. Focus on the tools to get you there, as opposed to fretting over, you know, string gauges and string tension and whatnot. So I'm talking a lot. Can I open, does anybody want to ask me stuff? I'd love to answer some questions if anybody wants to ask anything. Brave first soul, yes.
So I think I saw you earlier using your thumb.
Yeah.
Do you use that a lot to bar like the bob strings while you do like melodies on the top, or like, you know, different chords on the top?
Yeah. I'll show you an example. So for those of you who didn't hear, he's asking about my thumb. I use my thumb a lot, as you guys may or may not notice. That's something that someone tried to train out of me when I was younger. I took 3 or 4 lessons in 1995. I was 13 years old. And I took 3 or 4 lessons, and he saw my thumb perched over the neck, and he was like, "Don't do that." I was like, "Why?" And he says, "Because when you leave your thumb over the neck, your hands are slanted. And if you look at guys like, I don't know, like Jeff Loomis or Jason Richardson or something like that, or like Guthrie, any of these amazing shredders, you'll notice their fingers are almost always parallel to the frets. And they have these like spider-like hands. And it actually looks like a spider the way they play. And that's not me. Like, I don't consider myself a shredder. I'm very proud of what I do, and I, you know, I have pride in what I do, but I'm not a shredder, right? I'm a songwriter, and I notice that my fingers are slanted all the time, leaving me in a more vulnerable position if I want to do stuff high on the neck, or if I want to do like crazy, you know, shred stuff. But what it allows me to do is use my thumb to fret power chords, and that's why I started playing in drop tunings when I was younger. I noticed. That, you know, a lot of people were doing this to play a power chord, right? Just one finger across. You know, you go see any local band play and they're all doing that finger across. But what I realized was that you could use your thumb to fret those bottom two strings, and then you had 4 fingers left over to fret a bigger, more complex, specific chord, right? It's not just a power chord. It's not just a power chord. You can make it whatever you want to be. So you can have that be the root note and fret it with your thumb, just as an example. Use the rest of your 4 fingers to fret a bigger chord. Some riffs that we have in Periphery that you can't play without your thumb. There's a song called Mile Zero off of Periphery 2. The opening riff is. And that second chord is a nightmare. Unless you use your thumb. If you use your thumb, it's. If you were to not use your thumb. That, which is stupid. Sorry? Yeah. You said you had a question?
No, I have a question. Why you have to.
Oh, yeah. Again, it's all just born out of what I thought sounded cool at the time. And now it's part of my style. And I think the other guys, I see Misha sometimes using his thumb, and that makes me very proud. I'm like, good boy. Yeah. Can I take another question? Yeah.
Who moved the second grade on that thumb? I've seen you do the second grade.
Yeah. So in Reptile, in the song that I just played, there's a, I think you're referring to. The point was to just find the most like evil, like black metal guy on the edge of a cliff, you know, that kind of sounds. What's that? The second time is funny. So people always ask, why do we have three guitar players? And this is a perfect example of why we have three guitar players. So I think I'm playing live when we play Reptile, I'm playing. And Misha's playing. Jake's playing. We've got two half-step dissonant parts and then a low part. And when you get it all together, whew, like, and I'm not trying to like, you know, worship myself, but damn, it sounds good. And that's why we have three guitar players. And then there's a tapping part where. We're all tapping a half step apart from each other. So I'm playing. I think Misha's playing. I think Jake is playing. And it's like, it's so stupid. It's so dumb. But it's one of those things that like, it comes from having fun in the studio, you know? Like, what do we do there? Like, how can we make that sound more chaotic? And what we learned very early on in our careers was that there's no rules. There's no rules. Like, if it sounds cool and it makes you smile and you're like, damn, it's kind of awesome, just go with it. Just go with it. And that's the whole point behind our music. Like, there's a rhythmic playfulness to the music and there's a melodic playfulness. And I think when you hear Periphery, it's like that feeling I got when I first heard Killswitch Engage or something like that. You know, you can hear a band that sounds like they're having fun. And that to me is always the most appealing part of playing this style of music, is that you can hear how much fun people are having, you know? And not that we don't take ourselves seriously, but that's always at the crux of what we do. We gotta have fun, yeah.
Two-part question, do you play any other instruments?
No, I know no other instruments, no. I always wanted to be a drummer. I always wanted to be a cool drummer guy, yeah. Because they look like they have a lot of fun and also, this type of music, I feel, you gotta understand drums to know how to write it, too. Like, I understand drums, I know how to program drums, and it's like the first time you hear Meshuggah, you know? You don't understand it until you hear what the drummer's doing, and you're like, oh, it's just in four. And he's just playing in four the whole time. You hear where that crash cymbal hits, and it's at the end of four bars. It's all in 4/4. So as soon as you understand that, you understand Meshuggah, and kind of understand Dillinger, but I'm not there yet. Yeah, yes, sir, in the back.
Deeper personal questions, so I apologize.
Yeah.
But I have to know, do you enjoy pineapple on pizza?
I don't want to answer too much personal stuff on the stage, man. That's a really personal question. That's like asking who I voted for, you know? I love pineapple on pizza. Yeah, that's right. I don't get when people are so militant about food, you know? When people are like, oh, fuck pineapple on pizza, deport this guy. Like, it's food, man. It's food. Eat what you want to eat, and I'll eat what I want to eat. How about that? Yeah.
Trying cranberries instead of pineapple.
What? All right, deport this guy. Craisins on a pizza? Can I see your passport? Do you have a...
I worked at a pizza shop for 5 years, and I don't like the texture of pineapple, but...
I really like you already. In
Baghdad?
Oh, no, Jesus Christ. No. 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 Yeah. Yeah, there's a couple reasons for that. No. Tuning for us is always one of those things where it's just like, if we're feeling tapped out of ideas, try out a random tuning. That's how Scarlet was written. That's how a ton of our other songs are written. Speaking of weird tunings, can I throw, I've just thrown my guitar and drop A. Can I play another song for you guys? What's that?
Maybe.
We'll be right back.
you.
Yeah, can I take any more questions? Anybody got anything else to ask? Yeah.
Yeah, so we hear a lot of Periphery music, especially like Tom Shores music, which by the way, you can definitely make this every album.
Thank you.
But there's a shit ton of black metal influence. I know it's probably a lot of you. Is that kind of you toggling in your influences, or are Misha and Jay kind of black metal fans too? Or sounds like kind of a little more.
Yeah, I grew up a huge fan of black metal. My favorite band growing up was Emperor. Like I discovered like Metallica and Pantera and stuff like that early on, like in the 90s. And then I got into like Devin Townsend, and then I discovered Emperor, and that was life changing. And you should see some of my photos when I was a teenager. I used to like get up like corpse paint and stuff, and like wear like studded bands with like spikes. It was awesome. I kind of wish I still. Never mind. But it's never too late, I guess. I've always had a love for that kind of stuff. Like, I was a big fan of thrash metal when I was younger, and I think that's why I fell in love with black metal. I just love really fast, like, intense, off-putting music. Like, music that you could show your parents, and they would be like, what is wrong with my kid, you know? And I think that's why I liked it, because there was, like, that whole rebellious punk rock aspect to it, you know? That's part of being a kid, is pissing off your parents. But yeah, I mean, that has always been a huge influence. And yeah, I don't know if I'd necessarily take credit for that kind of, that sort of surfacing in Periphery's music, but I do always lobby for blast beats. Like if there's a choice, I'm just like, can we just see what it sounds like with blast beats, this part? So I'm always that guy. And you know, to have an outlet like Haunted Shores, which if you guys don't know, Haunted Shores is the name of my side project that I have with Misha. And the point of Haunted Shores is exactly what he was just mentioning, is just to get all of that out of our system. So blast beats, trem picking, just, you know, it's instrumental too, so we don't have to think about a singer. We can make it as busy as we want, and we can make it as just pissed off and brutal as we want. So yeah, I'm gonna play a Haunted Shore song a little bit for you. Yeah. Yep.
So you said you're always lobbying for blast beats. How does Matt feel about that?
That's a really good question. Yeah.
When you guys have those discussions about drums, especially with a lot of stuff,
yeah,
program, how's
that go? That's a good question. He's asking about what our drummer thinks of that kind of stuff, like of us being like, oh, we got to put blast beats there. And ultimately, Matt has the final say. But me, Misha, and Jake are the three main songwriters in the band. So the way a Periphery song is written is me, Misha, and Jake will get into a room together, and we'll see which one of us has a riff that we like, or two riffs, or three riffs, and then we'll record them, and we'll program drums to them. And then we'll just add on. We'll see who's inspired. We'll see who has a riff in a similar tuning, or in that tuning, or a similar feel, or a similar tempo. And then we just sort of like ride each other's creative momentum to finish a song. Like I was talking about Reptile. We wrote Reptile over the course of 3 or 4 days. And it ended up being a 16-minute song. I had two riffs, and then Misha and I wrote the chorus, and then Jake added the clean section in the middle, and then Misha wrote the next part, and then me and Misha wrote the next part. It's just we all sort of ride each other's creative momentum in the process. Programming drums is something that, okay, you guys know that Misha is really talented, but I think that one of the craziest abilities I've ever seen in another human being is how fast he can program drums. It's nuts. I don't know how many hours he spent doing it. It has to be in the tens of thousands of hours he spent doing it in his life. But he does it effortlessly. So when we program a demo, Misha programs the drums, and we'll program whatever we want to hear. And then Matt will get it, he'll hear it, he'll digest it, and then he'll say, yeah, could we swap this out for that? I'm gonna try this different feel over this part. And then he'll come in with his suggestions, and then from there we'll mold the song out of it. But yeah, we all have our own ideas of what drums should sound like, but ultimately Matt always has the final say. Yeah.
So in 4, there was a shift towards kind of more electronic stuff. Do you think because you guys know Nolly is not touring, mm-hmm. that you guys shifted that to kind of cover the bases a little bit?
Mm. I don't know, because when I listened back to Periphery 1, there was some electronic stuff, and Periphery 2 had an all-electronic song on there, the song Epoch. That was all electronic, and that's always kind of been not a main focus of Periphery sound, but it's always been this like nice palate cleanser that we like to have. Like, you may hear some glitchy stuff, you may hear some electronic stuff. I don't think Nolly leaving, don't take this the wrong way, I know this is being videotaped, so I can't speak too ill of my good friend Nolly. But we had good years while he was in the band. Our ex-bass player, he's no longer with us. He's still alive. he's just not in the band anymore. But I don't think it's affected us on a musical level, to be honest. He helped write a couple songs on Periphery 3. Like Prayer Position, he wrote the main riffs for him. But other than that, like, he never was a main songwriter for the band, despite the other things that he did amazingly for us, and he still does. But him leaving, I don't think it really impacted us on a creative level. I miss the guy, and it's awesome to have him in a band with you. Like, he's so smart, and he's so talented. He's a better lead player than all of us. And it's always cool to have a guy like that around, because you feel always inspired by somebody like that. But I don't think it really impacted us on a creative level, to be honest with you. I think the electronic stuff you'll always hear in Periphery's music, because we all love electronic music in the band. Misha and Jake had a really cool electronic side project called 4 Seconds Ago that I hope we start incorporating a little bit more of that in Periphery's music. I want Periphery to be a big passion project, you know? Like, if you guys are surprised by what you hear on the next album, that's a success to me. I always want to keep people on their toes. Can I play a Haunted Shore song for you real quick? Awesome. All right, so this is from said side project, Haunted Shores. It's a song called Harrison Fjord. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. It's a fast one. Can I? I've been ignoring some people. I think.
So, forgive me if I'm wrong, but you don't really know any theory, right? So, how do you visualize?
As I drink a beer. No, I don't know theory. No.
How do you visualize your fretboard?
Okay. So he's asking about my knowledge of theory. Or lack thereof. I don't know theory. Misha and Jake, the other two guitar players in the band, they don't know theory either. So we're all self-taught. And I know how to tune a guitar, kind of. But that's kind of, and I know if someone says, you know, play A flat, like I can do that. And I know where everything is on the fretboard, but if somebody says play an Lydian, is that the Simpsons one? Which one, what mode is that? Is anybody? That's Lydian? See? I know theory. But it was never something that I learned. Like, and the same goes for Misha and Jake. Instead, and I know from speaking to them about their upbringings and their backgrounds, is that we all just kind of learned by hearing music that we liked and just spending time with the music. I know that's kind of a cop-out answer. Just use your ear, man. Just trust your ear. It's like kind of a bullshit answer. But it really is all about exposure to music. So if you really, and some younger players ask me sometimes, they're like, is there a shortcut to get good? And I always say that you have to just spend time with the instrument. Just spend time with the instrument. Spend time with the music. And the reason I learned by my ear was because that's all I cared about. Like, I was obsessed. I was obsessed with it, with learning whatever Alice in Chains song was on the radio, or figuring out how to play that Red Hot Chili Pepper song I saw on MTV, you know, or whatever. Like, I was just obsessed. That's all I could think about. All I could really focus on. And I think that really came in handy the last 10 years of my life, because when you go through that kind of struggle, you're used to trusting your ear. And that's all I do now. It's like me, Misha, and Jake, none of us know theory, but theory is a language. And the cool thing about finding people who you trust musically is you all share that language. You trust their vision and you trust, like, you guys ever jam with a drummer or a guitar player and you're like, yeah, I get this guy. And this person gets me too. That's a language where it's unspoken, and you kind of understand where each other are going musically. And that to me is just as handy as theory, is having that kind of relationship with somebody. So, to be honest, I'm really just going by my ear all the time. And I can speak for the rest of the guys when we say that, you know, we have one mantra in Periphery, and if it sounds good, let's go with it. Like, it doesn't need to make sense. It doesn't need to make anybody happy. It just needs to sound good. That's all. Yeah. You had a question too.
Yeah. What step did you take early on in your career to promote the music yourself?
Oh man, we could be here for a while. We want to talk about this. I was just talking about this last night. So he's asking about how we got to start promoting our music early on in our career. It's really easy to make fun of MySpace, right? but that's how we came up. And we gave our music away on MySpace. Everything was free. You could download it right off the MySpace player in the top right of the page. Everything was free. We didn't care about charging 99 cents a song. We didn't care about charging for albums, any of that, because for us, the goal was to generate a buzz, right? To get people interested in your music. We weren't trying to make money, because I had always heard that you can't make money off of music in the beginning. You know, and I'm not rich. Like, guitar is my living now, but I'm not a wealthy person, and I barely see any money off of Periphery, to be honest with you. And the first 4 or 5 years of Periphery, I went into debt really bad on the money side. And so anyways, to summarize, money was never the motivation, and it still isn't the motivation. It has to be more of a factor in my life, because I'm 37, and I can't just say, you know, money's not important. You have to survive. But back in the day, I was working a full-time job. I worked in Washington, D.C. I worked, 45, 50 hours a week for the government. And I did music stuff full-time, and I was not sleeping. But at that point, music was more important than everything. My job was also important because I needed to make a living. But we knew that to build a buzz, you have to put that at the forefront of everything. You can't make a dime off of anybody if they don't know who you are, right? You can't go up to a stranger on the street and be like, hey, dude, you want to buy my CD for $5? I'm like, why would I buy your CD off for $5? I don't know who you are. So for us, getting the music out there, getting it heard, was objective number one. And fortunately, we got lucky because people liked it, because we put a lot of work into it. And that's what the goal was at the beginning, was to put a ton of work into the product without thinking about the financial side. Just put all of our blood, sweat, and tears into the music at first. And then you build a buzz, and then the record labels and the promoters and the managers and the booking agents all come to you. So if you guys are in bands out there, I would highly urge you to not spam record labels with your demos. Don't send them your CDs. Don't send them your demos. Don't wait for them to come to you. And by waiting, I don't mean literally wait. I mean build your buzz. Work on your product. Work on your live show. Work on how good you guys sound live. Work on the songs. Get those to be where you feel really proud about them. And play shows. Just play shows, because that's the one thing that can never go out of style, is having a good live show. Now you can program drums in your bedroom, and you can record guitars in your bedroom, and have your music on Spotify in 3 to 4 days. It's crazy. So in that way, the industry's changed in a big way. But one thing that's never gonna go away, and one thing that will always get people's attention, is having a good live show. So I always say, put your time and effort into that. I really, really got off topic here. But yeah, anyways, I could talk about this for hours, but I would say in the early days for us, it was all about focusing on the music and getting it out to people, as opposed to the financial side. And that way, you get leverage. When record labels come to you, you have the leverage because they approached you. You didn't knock on their door. You didn't send them a million CDs. When you do that, they have the leverage. And so they can lowball you. They can give you the worst record deal you ever thought of. And record deals are not the be-all, end-all of a musician's career anymore. I remember when I was growing up, the goal was like, oh, we got to get signed, and then we'll be millionaires. End of story. The end. Credits. But that's not the case. That's really not the case anymore. Record deals don't really mean much anymore if you're not willing to put in the work for yourself. So that's part of a deeper conversation. You shouldn't do any of this if you don't consider it objective number one in life. And that's the only reason I do what I do. I don't do it for popularity. I don't do it for money. I don't do it to meet people. I love you guys. You guys are awesome. But I don't do it to make anybody happy. I do it because it's the only thing in my life that I really give a serious shit about, you know? And it's the only thing I've cared about since I was a kid. And so that's the reason to do it. If you don't feel that way about music, keep it a hobby. Keep it a hobby. There's nothing wrong with that. But yeah, if you really, really have any aspirations of doing anything, you gotta make it your passion, your life's blood, you know. So, anyways, yeah. Hope that wasn't too much of a rant. Yeah.
My question has a little bit to do with that money too. Is it right to all three of you do different pickups?
Yeah.
Does that have
any money? No. Yeah. So he's saying that all three of us use different pickup companies, and that's a complete coincidence. Like. So same thing with guitar companies. Misha uses Jackson, Jake uses Ibanez, I use PRS. I use Seymour Duncan, Misha uses Bare Knuckle, and Jake uses DiMarzio. That's, you know what, honestly, it's NAMM. Every time we go to the NAMM show in LA, we, historically, we just meet people. And I met the Duncan family, and I really love them. And I said, hey, would you guys ever be down to build a pickup set? So you guys know a guy named Keith Merrow? Yeah, Keith and I became friends, and he was working with Duncan at the time. And he said, just come out to Santa Barbara, California, where their company is based, and we'll build a set of pickups. So that was all just happenstance. It kind of just happened coincidentally. But it's fun. Not financially driven whatsoever. Yeah. Yes, sir, in the back.
So you guys have basically become masters at, like, recording everything on your own. What is, like, the like your general basis to ensure that you're gonna have a good recording? Like, what are the things that you guys like mentally check off? Like, do you like catch the fire at the spark kind of thing, or like, is it like tier consideration? What are your biggest things when it comes to recording personally?
Recording ourselves, yeah. He's asking about how that happens, right? Like, So there's one thing that I would urge anybody who's interested in recording yourselves: make sure you have the personnel to do it. Make sure that you trust whoever's going to be handling the engineering side is fully capable, because that's the only reason that we're able to do it, is because I trust Misha and Nolly. Those two are the main engineers in the band. I know a little bit about it, but I'm by no means like, you know, Mr. Producer Engineer guy. But I have faith in those guys. And if I ever lost an ounce of that faith, I would suggest we go with a different producer. But again, it's all gut. It's all gut. Like, whatever your gut tells you. Like, if you think that your music could be better with a producer, have a conversation with your band and say that, guys, we should just try recording with somebody. We tried recording with a producer one time, and the results were horrendous. And none of you will ever hear that, because I refuse to let anybody hear that. We recorded the song 22 Faces with somebody who I will not name. It came out on Juggernaut. But before that album, we recorded that song with somebody, and it was one of the most miserable experiences of our career. Having somebody, because we're all very opinionated, like all five of us in the band, we're really opinionated. So to have that extra party, you know, breathing down the back of your neck and telling you what you should and shouldn't be doing, for us it's jarring. But if you're comfortable with that, if you're comfortable with somebody's vision and you trust their vision, then by all means, you know, go for it. And, again, it all goes back to personnel. The personnel in my band tells me, as sure as I am that my name is Mark, that we are a self-produced band, I think, till the end of our career. Yeah. Can I show you guys a special thing that I brought? Okay.
Yeah. I brought something that was just announced 3 days ago. And there's not any of these floating around, like anywhere. They're not even stored today. This is a new 7-string model that we
debuted online. Yeah, this is a prototype. This prototype I received like 7 or 8 months ago. I toured with it a couple times, and this was what they sent me to approve for the SE model that just got announced 3 days ago. And I brought it to play a song, but more importantly, I want you guys to get your hands on it too. So after I'm done, in a little bit here, I'm gonna leave it at the front stage and I want you guys to play it. So you can see what it feels like. And again, take advantage of this, please, because this is not gonna be in stores for a little bit. So again, this is a preview of what's to come. 26 and a half inch scale length, long scale, same pickups, Seymour, Duncan, Alpha, and Omega, and flat fretboard, just like in the 6-string. But yeah, can I play a song on it for you guys? All right. The song is called Make Total Destroy. Yeah, I'm still really stoked on how this guitar feels and sounds. It's like, it's my new obsession. Because I haven't played it for very long, and I really want everybody else to feel how damn good it is. So it just handles everything you need it to handle as far as the 7-string goes. How many 7-string players do we have here, by the way? Oh, that's not that many of you. Okay. You have an 8-string?
Yeah.
That's a different world right there. Yeah. Yeah. A 7-string, I would say for anybody who's curious to pick up a 7, it opens things up quite a bit. You can't treat it like just another guitar. It's almost like you have to learn a new instrument. But once you get the hang of a 7-string, it opens things up quite a bit. And again, it's one of those things. The reason I like to play different guitars, and the reason I like to try out different types of gear, and the reason I like gear is because it pulls inspiration out of me. I'm not a materialistic person. I don't buy guitars just because I like to look at them. I don't buy pedals because I like to look at them. And for me, having tools is just to pull creativity out of myself. And again, if I'm feeling tapped on a 6-string, that's why I go to a 7. Or if I feel like I'm not writing anything cool on my guitar, I know this is a PRS event, but sometimes I'll pick up a Tele. Sorry. But I mean, just to get a different flavor. Just to get a different flavor. I have my favorites and I have my fallbacks, my standards, right? But again, to me, gear is all about pulling out that creativity. Or if you're not a songwriter, just pulling out the fun. Because this is all supposed to be fun. You know, like, you ever sit and play guitar so long that you feel pissed off? You're like, oh my God. Like, I just saw Steve Vai play last week or like whatever, and I can't. Why am I never gonna be as good as Steve Vai? Guess what? You're not gonna be as good as Steve Vai. But that's not the point. The point is just to have fun. And I tried really hard to be Yngwie Malmsteen in the 90s. Because I wanted to be that good. But I soon realized that that wasn't going to happen, and that, to me, guitar was about embracing the aspects of the instrument that you find to be fun. And whether it's a hobby, whether it's your living, whether it's somewhere in between, you always got to have fun with it, because it's not supposed to be a chore. Life is too crazy. Work is too hard. Family is too stressful. There's traffic and rush hour and commutes and crying babies and angry family and whatever. Like, life is nuts, but this always should be an escape, whether it's your living or whether it's just a hobby. So have fun with it. And that's how I found my own voice. And I don't think I'm the best guitar player in the world, but I know that I have my own voice. That's what I have faith in. I have pride in that, because I embrace the aspects of the instrument that I find to be fun. Yeah. Damn, I didn't realize I was gonna sound like a Reading Rainbow monologue. Guys, I'm running a little short on time. I can take a couple more questions, and then I'll play another song, but I'm not in any hurry to get out of here. I'm going to hang out and meet you guys if you want to do that. Yeah?
You guys toured the world with a bunch of different acts. I'm just curious, what band was it that, blew you away quickly
and there's two really easy answers to that. He's asking about, so we've toured a lot over the years, and we've toured with a bunch of different bands. Are there any bands that sort of make us pinch ourselves? The first one was Dream Theater in 2011. They invited us on a European tour. And at the time, we were just a club band. We were playing to 150, 200, 300 people a night. And then the first show of that tour was an ice hockey arena in Finland. Sold out, 12,000 people. And we were right before Dream Theater. We were the only opening band. And we talk about palms looking like they were covered in Crisco. Before you go on, you're like, oh my God, I can't believe we're about to do this. And going through the hallway and you see, Petrucci and all those guys warming up and they're asking you how your flights were, but you're not listening because you're so nervous. You can't talk because you're just sweating bullets. And that was a big rude awakening for our band, touring with Dream Theater, because we saw how it's supposed to be done. And we learned a lot. Back in those days, we just used to have a beer and then go play on stage. We wouldn't warm up. And we saw that Petrucci would play for 3 to 5 hours a night before he went on stage. And Jordan Rudess would practice, and Mike Mangini would practice, and John Young would practice. LaBrie would do his crazy warm-ups, and we saw how the pros did it. So I think that was the most important thing that we learned. These guys have done it for 30 years? more than that. And that was a big lesson for us to see how those guys did. And I think above all of that is they're still people. They're still humble. They're still modest about what they do. I don't know if you guys have ever met any of the Dream Theater fellows, but yeah, Petrucci, class act. All those guys are class acts. And that was also a big lesson. Was if you're famous, you don't have to be a douchebag. You can be cool. You can be a normal person. So yeah. And then the second one was Deftones. Touring with Deftones. Yeah, 2013. That was crazy because White Pony was my favorite album growing up, and getting to watch those guys every night was a total trip. Yeah. And again, another example. Your heroes don't always have to be douchebags. Yeah. And those guys are the opposite of that. They're just such sweethearts. I'm gonna get to you over there.
So with Pale Sand, really with every album that you guys have done, it kind of grows and evolves, has a bit of a stylistic shift to it.
Yeah.
I think they all kind of have their own identities. And I know we talked about like what affects the creative process, but what maybe shapes or directs how you decide an album wants to sound, or like what causes that change and puts you in the right direction where you get the album that you want? Is it more about the process or something that inspires it?
You guys are asking some good questions. That is all a matter of just, okay. All right, okay. So there was the demo. The first working demo we had for Hail Stand was It's Only Smiles. Was this. I showed the guys this riff. So we were recording Periphery 3. This was 4 years ago. And I wrote this riff during the Hail Stand session. And it was so happy and like positive sounding that I was just like, Here's a riff, but it's not going to be a Periphery song. I was like, I don't know what it's going to be for, but it's definitely not Periphery. And then we put on a 7-string, and we wrote like a chorus after that. And we're like, wow, this actually could be a Periphery song. And that was the first working demo we had for Hail Stand. And I almost thought it was going to be like a really melodic, sort of bubbly album, like a really positive sounding record. And then, like I said, the next idea we wrote was Reptile. It's like the darkest, most pissed off 16-minute song. And then we wrote That Wave. We wrote While You're Ghosts. And then we wrote, Churchman was another one. Blood Eagle. Blood Eagle was an accident. You wanna know how Blood Eagle came about? Okay. All right, so we have a photographer on tour with us named Randy Edwards, really talented guy. He showed us this trick where if you fret the first fret and you leave this fifth string open, and then you lay your pinky down as an artificial harmonic somewhere between the third and fourth frets, you get this. It's like a half-step dissonant artificial harmonic. It's really messed up sound. Again, the dumbest trick ever. But we thought it was such a cool effect that we're like, we gotta write a riff with that tuning. So that's how Blood Eagle came about. And I think all the dark sort of the darker songs on the record came at the beginning. And it really is just all about where the momentum is established. Like, Periphery 3 was a really fun record. We started it with Marigold and The Way the News Goes. Those are the first two songs written. And so I think the rest of the song had a really the rest of the album had a really playful, sort of like jumpy, acrobatic feel to it, you know? And Hail Stand, in contrast, is a darker album because of where it started. So it's very fluky. Yeah, it's very fluky. I can take two more questions and I'll play another song for you guys. Yeah.
So when it comes
to you guys as a band, how do you go about creating stuff like syncopated rhythms or like intricate riffs? Oh man, so he's asking how we come up with the syncopated riffs and the intricate rhythms. It goes back to something I said earlier. It's not calculated. It's really not calculated. For us, well, step one, we just really like Meshuggah. No, I'm just kidding. But it all comes from a mentality of liking to sound playful rhythmically. And that's where our heads are at. When we're writing, we're not trying to be, like, we take our craft seriously, but ultimately what makes us satisfied with a song is how happy it makes us. If we get that, like, feeling, you ever get this bass when you listen to it, you're like, like this, like, snarl kind of look, that means that we're happy. That means it's like, oh, damn, there's something, like, kind of filthy happening there, you know? And so that's the mentality behind the songwriting process. And rhythmically, there's so much you can do with a dumb riff, right? Like, you take the verse riff of Icarus Lips. Melodically and technically, there's nothing happening there. It's all one note, you know, and a low note. But the rhythm is what makes it cool and what makes it playful. So for us, we always have that, like, that playful aspect in mind. It doesn't need to be the most complicated riff, but as long as it has that, just like, sort of like, there's a feel. And I'm sorry, it's kind of a cop-out answer, but I swear to God, it's genuine. It's not calculated. It really just comes from the way we look at music. And if it sounds fun, if it sounds a way that sort of makes your eyebrow go up, you know, you're like, oh damn. And a lot of it comes from accidents. Like, you record a little bit in Pro Tools or Cubase and you shift it back a couple beats and you see what it sounds like. You get some really happy accidents that way. We've had so many of those happen over the years. And again, that's where a lot of the rhythmic stuff comes into play. Shifting things back a beat, shifting it forward a beat, shifting it back a half beat. So it starts on an upbeat instead of a downbeat. It's little things like that, just little fluky things. Can I take one more question? And then I'll play the last song, yeah.
Just a brief explanation of your main clean tone and your main, just, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, right now I'm using something very different. So I'm using, like I said, the MT-15 tonight, but live, Periphery is an Axe Effects band. We use all Fractal Audio Axe Effects. And for those of you who have seen us live, you'll see that we don't have pedal boards. We have no pedals, no foot switches, no pedal boards whatsoever on stage, because we have a MacBook Pro hooked up to our Axe Effects that basically tells our Axe Effects when to switch presets. On stage, and it's a pain in the ass because we have to program it before a tour. So before we tour, we'll get together for a week and we'll practice, but also program all of our preset changes. So we'll go into a Cubase session and we will open up a MIDI lane for each guitar player, and in this MIDI lane we'll take a pencil tool in the DAW, and then we'll program what number patch to switch that corresponds to the Axe Effects. And it takes forever because I have dozens of preset changes per song, and so do the other guys. So it takes quite a lot of work. And if you're comfortable with relying on technology to that degree, I'd say try it. But yeah, it definitely takes a lot of work, but it pays off in the long run, to where you want to run around the stage and not have to step on pedal boards. It's a lot of fun. But as far as our clean tone, there, again, it's all Axe Effects. It's all just different amp models that we like in the Axe Effects. Yeah. If you come to see us live, you'll see kind of how it all works. And I think a lot of people are surprised when they see how simple our setup is on stage. Despite what I just told you, it's simple because there's not much else going on. It's Axe Effects, MacBook Pro, some cabs on stage that are not mic'd. We don't mic any cabs. We have nothing coming out of the PA. It's all for stage sound. It's all for the front rows. So I'm sure, like, when you guys are sitting up here, you're hearing a lot of cab, and they're not hearing that much of it. They're hearing more PA. So that's why we have cabs on stage, just to make the front rows happy. But yeah, I hope that kind of answers your question. I'm going to play one more song for you guys. But before that, I want to thank More Guitars and PRS for doing this for us. Thank you. And thank you guys too from the bottom of my heart for coming out and doing this. I do this pretty much for fun because it's one of the ways I have fun away from tour, away from the band. So You guys have no idea how much it makes me happy to see all your faces here. So thank you guys so much for coming, really. I'm hanging out for a little bit afterwards, so come say hi. I'll leave the guitars, like I said, in the front of the stage so you guys can try out, especially the 7. Please try out the 7. This song is called The Way the News Goes. Thank you so much. More Guitars is giving away a ton of free stuff. So stay right where you are. I think they have a t-shirt cannon they're gonna fire at you point blank.
Oh,
No. Sorry. I gotta go. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you once again. Thank you.